name's Allison Perlman. I work with Boston Parks, and I'm the project manager for Rachel from Deer's Park. I also have Marcel Jean-Guard, who is the outreach coordinator for Parks, and Kyle Zick from the Kyle Zick Landscape Architecture, who's the principal. And then we have Brayden, who works with Kyle as well. So thanks for coming out. As I said, I think I attended the North Square meetings, I'm sure many of you did, and that time of year it was freezing cold and hard to get out, and now it's hard to get people to meetings because it's so beautiful out. So I do appreciate your time out here. Tonight where it's gonna be, it's the first of a series of community meetings that we're gonna have. And the first meeting tonight is gonna discuss site history and existing conditions, uses, and then also we just really wanna hear your feedback. Following tonight, we'll have two other meetings. The next meeting will most likely be in June, and that will go over the site plan alternatives based on comments that we get tonight and through other sources before the next meeting. And then finally, the last meeting would be in July, most likely, and that will be the preferred final design. So I can't express to you how important these community meetings are. We really, I think that as a Parks Department, we are really limited in how we see parks, and we see them in moments in time, and the people that actually are out on site and that are using the plazas and the parks have so much knowledge that we can't imagine. And so it's so great to hear back your feedback in these meetings, and it's so important to inform the future of Rachel Revere Square. So after the three community meetings, then we'll move into design and construction. And that process moves fairly quickly. We're likely going to wrap up the design and go out to bid sometime in the winter. Is that right? Fall. And then we're hoping to look at construction in 2016. And I keep that really vague because we're at this, it's a challenging project and that we're trying to coordinate with a lot of other people. We're trying to coordinate with Public Works and North Square, and we're trying to coordinate with BTD and Boston Water and Sewer. And so we're still trying to figure out that timeline. So as I said, the community process is really important. It's a lengthy process in some ways. And once we move into design and construction, we really get moving fast, and it's really hard to stop that and step backwards if the community starts coming out at that point. So we really want to get as much input at this front part as possible. So thank you. If anybody has any questions about that information, oh, and the construction budget, everyone probably wants to know about that. So we have approved around $180,000 for construction. We've requested an additional $172,000, and we'll know more about that if we've actually been approved for that after fiscal year 16 is approved, which is by July. So, does anybody have any questions? Okay, great. Oh.
Does the Parks Department have any initial goals in terms of the renovation plans, or is it totally contingent upon the feedback you're going to anticipate from the community?
Well, our goals are to respond to the community and what they would like to see. And then also, obviously, we want to upgrade the square so that it's there's some issues with the wall, so we need to make sure to deal with that. We understand that there's issues with drainage out there. And so those are really kind of the things that are we know need to be fixed. But the rest of it is kind of up to the discussion that's going to happen in the next few months. Great, thanks. Well, with that, I'll turn it over to Kyle and
we can move. All right, thanks, Allison. So I'm gonna build on what Allison just said and just reinforce that truly tonight, we really wanna hear your comments, big or small. No detail is unimportant from who uses the park or when, what good things there are, what bad things. I mean, this is our chance to really learn as much as we can from all of you. And I don't have to spend much time telling you about where this park is or the context. You all certainly know that very well. But in terms of what we're studying, it is the confines of Rachel Revere Square, which is bounded by the wall. on several sides, and then the buildings here, not the sidewalks, but although if you have comments about the sidewalks, feel free to speak up about that. And we're not working on North Square, although if there's something that relates how the two spaces work with each other, we'd certainly want to hear that. As we start to look at any project, we think about, we zoom out a little bit and just understand where is our site in respect to other sites, and what does this site do compared to others? So where does it fit into the open space that you have? You have playgrounds, you have ball fields, you have waterfront sites, you have urban sites. So we just want to set the context of this is, so what should this park do because of the other inventory of open spaces or parks that you have? And then just zooming in a little bit more, just highlighting some of the landmarks and attractions near the park, just in that same mindset. So here we are, again, kind of in three dimensions, talking about the park here, and this wall, of course, which is a prominent feature of the space, just from different angles. We also step back and look at the history, and I know there are people in this room that know the history of the site way better than I do, but we look to old maps, descriptions, lithographs, and books to know what has been on this site to help inform the future, not necessarily to rebuild what is gone, but just to understand it. So this, I think our site is right in here. To just give you a sense, there were a number of buildings on site at one point, back in, I don't have the date of this, but colonial times. And then more recently, there was a hotel on the site, the Hotel Rome. Oh, and I should just back up and show. That is an image of the Hotel Rome in the upper left there. And then, you know, we've looked at other things as well. So this is an early photo of the first configuration of the park after the Hotel Rome was removed. Now, what's interesting, we found out recently that the designer, the landscape architect of this park, was also the designer of the product. So that's Arthur Shurtleff. And you can get a sense of that with some of the detailing of the wall, some of the kind of panels, but also the integrated seat. It's similar, but not exactly the same as what's in the product. So you can get a sense of, oh, okay, this was from maybe the same designer. In a similar tradition, maybe we're also helping parks with Prado, so I don't know if there's that's coincidence. But the flagpole in the center of the park, you can still see the reflection of these circles in the pavement that were there then. So whatever those were, I don't know if they were tie downs for the flagpole or something else, but they're still there. But otherwise, from the original design, it's the wall, integrated seating, and the fence. You'll see that the trellis and the tables came later, around 1976 or so. So I mentioned 1976. These are construction drawings from the firm of Carroll Johnson Associates. This is where the trellis and the tables were added. I think there was also a drinking fountain that was added. Now, Allison mentioned a key point that as soon as we do any improvements, we touch the park, there are some things that will be triggered in terms of code that we'll have to address. One of them is this fence here. Because code says if there's a grade change more than 30 inches, this has to be 42 inches high, and then no opening can be more than 4 inches. So we'd have to address that as soon as we touch the wall. You can also see that as an opportunity. Here's our chance to rethink that, and is this the appropriate edge for the park? There's also all kinds of issues with the retaining wall. This is looking right at kind of the point of the park, and where the wall converges, there's a crack right down through the bricks there, so there's obviously some movement going on. And then other things like that integral concrete seam around the perimeter, there's chips, he's falling and cracking. So there is kind of a laundry list of just repair items if we decide that's all we want to do. And other things like the tablet commemorating Rachel Revere is in good condition, but there are issues of rot with the trellis or the pergola. There was a drinking fountain here at some point. It's been removed, but that infrastructure is still there, but in what condition, we don't know. And we've heard, of course, there are drainage problems. There's puddling, but also problems with the drainage structure itself. So those are things we'll investigate. In terms of the uses of the site, we know that the site is loved by many and used by many. And depending on the time of day or the day, it's used different ways. This happens to be captured at the St. John's School, where it works out really well. It's a protected site with a limited amount of an opening, so there's not a lot of kids or balls kind of running out into the street. And that wall and the bench kind of work real well for that. The wall and the bench also work very well for a tour group that may come down the Freedom Trail and have a ranger-led talk, or if a tour bus stops and they might not be going into the Paul Revere House, this is a place to stage, talk about the Paul Revere House, and move on. So open pavement is a good thing in a lot of ways because it's very flexible. But you may tell me, yes, it's flexible, but it's asphalt. Could it be something more? And I'm not going to put words in your mouth, but I'm hoping to just kind of stir the soup a little bit to have some conversations as we go on. And so this is where I start to ask questions, and there'll be other questions that you can ask of me too, but I want to know, what's your first impression of the park? Somebody who lived there or worked near there, it may be hard to kind of go back to the first impression because it's just part of the fabric of your neighborhood. But also, what should change, what should remain exactly how it is? And then how should this park relate to the Paul Revere House or North Square? And what uses should the park accommodate? You can tick off exactly what it does now, or you say, well, oh, we have a real opportunity to do this, this, or this, or the current use really doesn't work, we change that. Or kind of the bigger question is, should the park just be repaired and tweaked, or is this an opportunity to change it dramatically? And I'm not leading in any direction, I just want to find out what you all think. So we'll go over kind of the process, but I'm happy to kind of open up the floor and go back through some of these questions and basically let you all talk from here on out. I just wanted to set the stage and give you a sense of what we're hoping to get from you. And if we have a lull of the conversation, I'll try to kind of get us going again, but I don't think that's going to be an issue. So who wants to break the ice?
I don't believe it.
This is a topic that has come up before, but the relationship between the square and this park, at least to those of us who are in the area.
You mean North Square?
North Square and Ridgewood is, you can't really separate them. Mm-hmm. And I know, Kyle, when we talked on the phone, the little seating that's there is the most uncomfortable place to sit and eat just because they're just not very comfortable tables and chairs. But if you take those away, and then you also take away the picnic benches that are now up in North Square, then you don't have seating for people to eat anywhere. Right now, more people are sitting up in the square because the picnic benches are actually more attractive, I think, for eating than these seats down here. So again, if you want to have a place for people to be able to sit and eat, it's got to be one place or the other. And how we can, the decision we make here without including a decision about North Square, and again, this is something that's been talked about, I think, by a number of us, and we don't know how to, we understand one is park, one is DPW. You just said that the sidewalk is not included. It is in the North Square.
That's right.
I'm assuming.
Yes.
So
just the left.
Yeah, which is a problem.
If there's money, that means something with the top. It's on the left side.
What do you mean the left side?
If you're looking at this picture right here, it's the left.
Our left.
Just
left
side.
That side,
yeah.
So not going
down.
I'm sorry. The left side of the park, not going along.
Oh,
right.
The left side.
But the one on the far side is not, because that's not in the
park. Does it turn the corner? How far is it?
I think you all go to at least, is it right here?
We don't have a set limit, but yeah, let's say right here.
So I guess to build on your question, tables and chairs for eating or flexible use, people are in favor of that, and generally this area will kind of
barrels.
Then, sorry?
More barrels.
Trash.
More trash.
Trash. Trash.
It's ridiculous, not smith, it's something really bad. And people eat anything every morning.
Well, just to follow up on that comment, it's hard to have a combination meeting because there's so many separate issues. And so, I mean, as you know, or many of you know, Public Works is here tonight, and we are continuing that conversation as we move through design with them. And if we hear the community saying, hey, we want seating and somewhere to sit and eat at one of these places, I think we should be able to accommodate in one of these places. So it's helpful to have that comment.
In the way that the two entities are working together, how are you, could you describe your method of how are you exchanging design drawings and ideas, meeting together in your process, maybe not the public forum, but sort of behind the scenes?
Yeah.
How are you addressing this as a whole?
Right now, we've just had meetings and discussions. We haven't done anything on design at all.
Do you have an idea in mind?
We slowed down our process to let them catch up. It's actually worked out well as well, so we're actually just going to slow us down regardless.
Is that part of your plan to be able to overlap and exchange drawings? And
I don't know about exchanging drawings, but we'll
meet back on your designs together to sort of.
The idea is to continue the meetings and discussions as we move through design and make sure that there's some kind of language between the two. We don't want to have completely separate designs. So we will continue that conversation and see how we can kind of create a space that is seemingly one space, but they maybe have separate uses.
Why is not one continuous instead of two different things? Why do you separate?
I think right now it's different uses, and it sounds like the school uses it for one.
No, the tourists, they go there as the boat. Not
maybe you're not understanding your question. So
why are we separating two different set of drawings?
Oh, because that's a property ownership piece. Parks Department doesn't own North Square. And while we're one city agency, while we're one city and we all work together, we still very much work in silos, which is, you know, it's fortunate, it's unfortunate. Leaves it open to people being a little more creative at times, because then you're not constrained to just
we
one
should,
line of thinking.
Should blame me, but to forget.
But it's a pre-existing designation of ownership. Like that's not something that we can necessarily.
It's not the same.
It's a city that it's the city that owns it, but each agency owns certain parcels. And that parcel falls under DPW, whereas Rachel Revere falls under Boston Parks. So we're technically, it's as separate as it's gonna get within the one city.
But let me just explain, the two sites are really different in terms of utilities. North Square has got a lot going on with utilities and roadways, and it's a really complex site when you consider utilities. Versus Rachel Revere is off to the side, it doesn't have that kind of complex situation, so it doesn't make sense. That's why Public Works owns North Square, is because it's a really a utility type of property. Just so you can understand that there's just parks couldn't do the North Square design necessarily because it's got a lot of utility work.
I would just like to open with that I applaud the thoughtfulness that's gone into your approach. Wonderful to come in without, you know, sort of a concept and say, what would you guys like to see? And I'm excited about the idea that Kyle has asked, you know, is this an appropriate edge? It's a great question. What should the surface be? What can possibly happen? I have a couple questions about it that maybe, apparently, you've studied it very well because you've drawn it well. Are the drainage problems within the park itself, are we talking about what spills over into the street and continues down?
I can think of a couple places.
Yeah.
There's puddles right up in this edge, and then the drain itself doesn't drain well. If people know of other puddles, please let me know. That's my understanding of it. It's been raining so long, it's hard to check.
It's hard to read.
Well, for what it's worth, why I do this, I don't know, but I've photographed during rainstorms the water that, that goes along the, from here to there, and there's one or two basins over there, which I imagine we'll have to coordinate with.
Is that in the street or on the sidewalk?
That's in the street.
Okay.
There are no basins in the sidewalk. And there, when there are, where, when there's torrential rain, whatever, that's where it all goes.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, I only thought of it when you mentioned drainage, that I don't know where all this water is going, but you as a landscape architect would know better how to deal with runoff and, you know, what would happen with whatever intervention you propose. And I'm going to ask you, I guess, I'm not going to suggest, you deliberately didn't suggest an alternative to asphalt. Are there materials, we saw work that you've done in the past and it's very exciting, are there materials that you suggest that might be, say, more pervious, might allow water to drain through the place, or would you alternate material, or how do you see that happening?
I think, not an easy answer to that, but I can kind of tell you how we'll approach it in terms of as we dive into it. I mean, we're going to look at a range of pavement material options. You know, we'll start at asphalt, we'll look at concrete, we'll look at all the variations of concrete, and then there's all kinds of unit pavers, we call it, but that could be concrete or clay bricks. Some of those are, and there's pervious options to all those things I just described. When we get into pervious ideas, we have to think about our surroundings and the soils. I mean, it's going to be urban fill here, which probably doesn't drain all that well. Plus, we have basements, so we have to be concerned about how much water we infiltrate into the ground. So it's not an easy answer, but I think we're open to looking at the range of pavement options. And I think the pavement here, I can kind of open this up as a suggestion, if your comments is, it's kind of a blank canvas. I mean, right now, it's asphalt that's painted for hopscotch or Foursquare. But think of it still as that, but it could be pavers that have an etching of a quote or a map or, you know, something related to the history. I just want to give you a sense that it doesn't have to just be a blank pavement. It can be part of the interpretation or the message of the site, too.
If I'm not mistaken, the park is basically at the bottom of a small hill that goes up to the top of North Square. Couldn't you solve some, if not all, of the drainage issues within the park by just changing or fixing the grade within the park? I'm assuming there's a slight slope to it, which is why the water accumulates at the bottom of the park.
Yeah, I think it's actually, as soon as we change this pavement and regrade, we'll be able to get it into a catch basin or a new catch basin. It's not insurmountable, it's actually pretty easy.
Well, so the surface really doesn't matter that much if you're gonna fix the grade.
That's right. Although there could be advantages from the Boston Water and Sewer side, you know, how much water we're putting down that existing drain, or if we find that drain doesn't work too well or isn't sized to accommodate what we have. So we'll do our due diligence to figure out what's the right approach in terms of the drainage. Yes?
I have an informational question. Do we know how much of the Shirtlift landscape survives there, and what exactly did Carol Johnson do to reconfigure the road?
I don't have the original Shirtlift drawings. I do have a couple sentences that he typed in an unpublished autobiography that basically says that he worked on this site. But I also have the Carol Johnson drawing, so I know kind of what existed in 1976, which I assume is what Shirtlift did. Shirtlift was responsible for the wall, the integral seat, and I think this fence, but not the shade structure or the tables that are under it. But this tablet and this wall were done as part of Shirtlift, as far as I can tell, in the asphalt. I think he put a flagpole in the center, which has been removed. And I'm getting all that from that early black and white photo that I showed. Let's see if I can go back to that without too much trouble. That photo. So this is what I think Shirtlift designed.
Yeah.
And was that taken soon after it was designed?
Well, I didn't know exactly what
cars look like. Cars are already 50s, yeah.
Yeah. So he did it in the late 30s or early 40s. I have to check the date.
The plaque has a 46 date on it.
Oh, it does. Okay.
Have you talked to Hope Cushing, who's just written a book on artificial
intelligence? I mean to, because I've talked to her. I went to a lecture that she has, and I have a book that is on my list to kind of circle back around and talk to her.
Because the Strickland papers at Harvard are pretty extensive.
Yeah.
She's been through them all, so she might have a very...
Yeah, that's a good suggestion.
From a school perspective, the principal of St. John's School, and the surface is kind of a key item for us. Our children go out there 5 days a week, every single day, and use that space. It's, now that we have a playground on North Street, that's a huge help. But we have 280 students, probably 200 of them utilize that space. And I just envision their teeth every day being spread out across the playground because of the surface. You know, it's not equal, it's not level. It's not to say we need a special surface, but I think that would be a key element in moving forward.
Right. And how important is it that there are painted, you know, panes or something?
Oh, that would be awesome. Yeah. But, you know, that's like above and beyond. Yeah. If we got a great surface for our kids, I think that would be wonderful. But hopscotch, four square. And I believe it would be utilized by the neighborhood as well, not just the school kids. We're not there all summer, so other folks would utilize that as well. And it is the only open space that we have for the school kids.
Do you need to just have one surface? Do you have?
You could have multiples. Yeah.
Where people are eating, you have a harder surface. Where the kids are, you use a rubberized surface.
Or grass, or, you know.
Yep, I think we're open to all of that. And I think that's good to know in terms of, you know, there's active use, all things running around where you can't be thinking about the surface at all, but there are other areas that, right, you may want just have furniture on it, and it might want to be a harder surface. Or...
I work with Nina, the caller of your husband. I think that your question originally about what were your first impressions of it, I think what I gather from visitors and what I sort of remember about my first impression many years ago is thinking that this is a park. It seems very hard as a park, like hardscape surfaces. And, you know, I think people, when we say to people, go, we'll meet you across the street in Richelieu Park, or reference that as the St. John's playground, people look at us like, are you serious? That's a playground. Like, that's where people go to play, and this is what they have in the city. And so I think that anything that you can do to soften those edges of it the experience that we find at our courtyard, and we have right now, we don't have plants in there, but we do have plants in there. People love to feel like that's an oasis in this city they've been walking through, and that the Rachel Revere Park could be that too.
I'm going to make an observation about Shercliffe, I guess, with respect to the Prado, and you've been to the Prado. And I also teach design studio, and we've used many of these sites as sort of site locations for what we're doing. The Prado is a highly formalized place. It is the connection between Hanover Street and the Old North Church. It is the procession, you know, it is the process through which you get from here to there. To me, it appears that same thinking was applied to this without the same objectives in mind, you know, this sort of formalized shape and dealing with the edges and continuous seating and all that, where edges maybe don't need to be. It was mentioned that the students use the space for, you know, during the day, all day long, and to some extent they enjoy the protective nature of the fence around it. But another part of it, to me, is if the square itself were protected, maybe we don't need as many of those fences to defend that space. You mentioned by the time you get to the outskirts of there, I think there's a difference of 5 or 6 feet between North Street and the top of that. So, but there's a gradient of elevation change around there that could be dissolved or gradually dissolved as we get around there.
So if, along
Along there. Like why, where you first had your hand, I would ask, why do we need that at all? Right? Because what purpose does that serve other as what, why couldn't we substitute that with a large bench and accomplish the same thing? The rest of it is protecting the kids who use it every day from traffic, you know, whatever other, yeah, from falling and that sort of thing. So anyway, the original thought was, I think Shirtcliff, I respect what was done in the Prado because there was sort of a goal to connect Hanover Street or St. Stephen's or whatever was in mind very formally to the Old North Church. But here, that same thinking was applied rather arbitrarily. So I think it ought to be challenged, and I hope we think creatively about ways that we can do that.
I mean, my guess, looking at kind of this era, is that he was kind of thinking about the axial relationship and the view up to this point, and then here's this object that would be centered between kind of the back, both of the buildings, and it's very much inward focused, you know, everything kind of points in. But that's been kind of changed a bit, you know, with the trellis and the seating. So, I mean, I think it's a good point to say, well, let's question, and that's why we're here. You know, what should we question and what should we not?
That's a question for the school. I go by there a good bit visiting the inner. There really are two primary uses there. It's the tour groups gathering there for talk.
Absolutely.
and the school. Is there a conflict? Do those two uses need to be separated?
Being part of the community, I think that's important that we're able to share space and to work together. The students are there. We have an after school program that runs till 6 p.m. So the kids are out, especially after school, between 2 and 6. And the tour groups are a little bit less at that point in time. During school day, you know, it is what it is. We're going to run into folks, but we're certainly willing or certainly able to share space, which I think is important. But I loved your idea of different surfaces. I think that's real important.
I'm also thinking different grade levels. I mean, yeah. It's brought up to one plane, but if you take where Carol Johnson put the... If you have that as a series of steps or on those seating benches, that becomes a nice little lecture amphitheater.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you don't have to worry about the wall. That's great. You know, just pull the wall out, take it down to grade, let four groups kind of sit there and be lectured at, and then have the space behind it more clearly delineated with a softer surface for the school.
So are you saying this portion could even come down to this level?
Yeah, just take it down in a series of, you know, steps that tour groups can sit on, terraces or whatever that you can sit on, and the tour guides can lecture and they can do, you know.
If I could follow up with a couple questions related to how the kids use it. Mm-hmm. So particularly after school, I'm thinking my own kids, trying to keep track of all the kids and they, you know. So is it helpful to kind of have only that way in and out?
Well, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, from our perspective, it's great because we can station teachers there and people to watch the kids. We know they're safe, we know they're secure. If it opened up a bit, we would just have to change how we deal with things, and certainly we have enough staff to be able to deal with that and, you know, open up the space and not make it as confined.
And the other follow-up question is, how much kickball or ball games and do they do, and do the balls wind up everywhere?
Pretty good.
Yeah.
So they do. They go all over the place.
Yeah.
But they use it a lot. Yeah.
We use it a lot during gym, and especially, you know, after school. That's really, you know, like I said, we have 100 kids in our after school program. So between North Street and here, you could have 40, 50 kids out in this space. You know, and they've used, they call it the park with nothing in it. And they love it because they can be creative and they can use, you know, they can create games and do different things. And there's like 5 games going on at the same time and nobody seems to worry about it, kid-wise. So it's a beautiful space for our kids. And they're pretty creative, like I said. So.
Well, I guess one other, sorry for all the follow-up questions, but I have one more.
Okay.
Thinking about the drinking fountain that's been removed, would that be a good addition if the drinking fountain?
I don't know. I have mixed reviews on drinking fountains.
Okay.
You know, our kids come with bottles of water and different things like that. So that, you know, trash cans, you know, for disposable trash, that might be something, because I think there's only one outside. That might be something to add.
I'd suggest a Big Belly or something, because we have
a
lot of...
Big Belly, do it. Fills up constantly.
Yeah.
It's all right next to the
yeah.
Very
cool.
And there's a barrel inside.
There's a barrel in, and the barrel in becomes our farm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it becomes a collection for all the things nobody wants near their own property. Get dragged in there. So we need more containers, and they probably all should be covered in some way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Another question I had is, last time I was here, there was a lot of beer bottles and cans. Is that something that happens often?
Yeah.
On the weekend.
Yeah.
Well, we just talked amongst ourselves. There's a third group of people who use it besides the tourists and the school children. That's the locals who congregate there in the evening. A lot of people go there and smoke a cigar, or have a meal, or consume beverages of various types. So, and in addition to that, you know, teenagers tend to hang out there at night too in the summer because there's no lighting there, and it allows them to do whatever they want to do in the shadows without being protected by adults. So, if you were going to keep some sort of seating or table under the structure that's in there, would it be possible to have some lighting there? Because I don't think there is any lighting there at all right now.
And does the wall help obscure the kids or not make a difference?
Yeah.
Or
it does. You can't see them at the tables from the street level.
I think also first impressions, just to follow up on that, I think a lot of people don't even realize it's there who are not familiar with North Square, that it's easy to just sort of walk right by it.
Right.
And
it's not very welcoming.
Not even, oh, there's another park there?
Yeah.
It's sort of a very common reply, a response to the area.
Well, again, I think it looks, it was dealt with architecturally just like the Prado, like, for that matter, Cox Hill Cemetery that has, you know, retaining wall around it and a fence. And fences, generally speaking, I think we should reconsider fences altogether, but I understand the concept of controlling the kids. And it's very exciting to hear them leave the school. It's like letting steam out of an engine, you know, from a sound point of view. And they just, you know, flow. And that flow is significant. And I think the park is a welcome respite, largely because the rest of the square is unprotected. Mm-hmm. And if the square were like a, what's it called, Woonerf? If we had strategy overall, how can we protect this entire? I don't want to broach a difficult subject, but I think it's difficult to segregate North Square and Rachel Revere Park. Though I understand the reasons why they're segregated, but I hope at some point, you know, the minds, your minds, and the minds that are working on North Square meet and you know, resolve that issue of. Well, how can we protect the folks that need to be protected and remove the barriers that otherwise are unnecessary?
I have a suggestion as to a possible explanation for why the fortress-like edging at Rachel Revere Park and its relation to the Prado. And my suggestion or explanation comes from writings of Shercliffe the son about his father's thinking in designing the Prado. And I remember specifically one of the things that Shercliffe the son says is that my father was concerned about destruction, and that is why the benches are of heavy granite with deep foundations. But he was also concerned about people driving onto the Prado, mm-hmm. so that if you notice, there are sort of, well, not bollards in the sense of maritime bollards, but there are barriers that will keep people from driving onto the Prado. And Shercliffe the son states that specifically as one of the ideas that his father had. Another one was the sloping surface of the wall, so that kids couldn't climb on the wall and do things that kids shouldn't do. It slopes so that they can't do that. That is the top. So that it was for protection of the Prado from misuse, mm-hmm. whereas that concern may not apply here and may not apply anymore.
Right. Good, thanks.
The design challenge, I think, is just that the walls create a safe spot. They also allow tour groups to sort of have a little bit of a quiet spot on a busy street where they can be talked to. But the same things that create that safety make it a little intimidating, a little sort of daunting, particularly this view. Yes. When you come up this way, there's nothing really attractive about that. It's less so as you get around to where the opening is, that starts to grade down. It's a little more, the height isn't that intimidating. So how you balance those two things, because I think for tour groups, having it be a little bit back and off is helpful for tour groups as well. So some of the things that work for the kids work for the tour groups, but how do you soften that? How do you make it look less like a fortress?
One question I want to ask the group is, how do you feel about the level of information that's conveyed in terms of history? So there's something about Rachel Revere here. There's a very small bronze sign, wayside. It's difficult to read here. It's kind of awkwardly placed, but is it the right amount of information? Is there another story we should be telling? I don't know. I'm just curious to hear what your thoughts on.
Yeah.
More is better.
Yeah.
And particularly in this case, I mean, this neighborhood has such a rich history going back to the 17th century. And the more that we can tell that history, the better. And in this case, we can come right up to the 20th century. And then I think it gives, all the uses that we've talked about, I think all the people who are using the park that we've talked about would benefit from better and more compelling interpretation.
Other thoughts on that topic?
Yes. If you are considering changing the upper portion of the wall, maybe making it into more of a bench or some sort of structure, it might be an opportunity to change the entrance to the park a little bit and maybe move that National Historical Marker that you referenced in the front to the entrance to sort of bring people into the entrance or something like that. Maybe a smaller plaque or something that describes what the space is commemorating. Because right now, I don't think the majority of the people that go through North Square even know that there's a plaque to Rachel Revere inside there.
We should talk to the Park Service, and we can certainly do that as you guys can. That wayside is shot. Yeah. It's if you're going to move it, I would move it like into an hour. Yeah, it's really, and we get complaints because you can't read it. I mean, it's really, and it's an opportunity, and I think the park, it probably should be put into the park's menu of things to do. So we could certainly push for that because I know it may be. Maybe outside your scope.
Nina, are you talking about the plaque
the
in
one
the center?
The one that sits by the
historical marker.
That's just a dedication when they did that in 1976.
No.
The kiosk.
Where the top is so worn that you can't.
Yes.
Now that's a Park Service wayside that probably went in and
I think that's symptomatic of a lot of this arbitrary sort of placement of things where it was convenient without this whole park is, we have this rigid formality around that central gabled Parthenon-like structure, and there's a plaque in the middle of it, and it's as if, you know, we centered everything around it, and it's just sort of, it's kind of a bizarre focus, if you will, where, you know, when we redid the Greenway, there was some thoughtfulness about organizing the history in a legible way that made sense. So I think that's maybe some similar consideration is appropriate for all the informational stuff that goes into this. I certainly wouldn't want it to come out of the budget for the renovation of the park.
Sure.
It seems like it should be something separate, and I would imagine you could spend an extraordinary amount of money on that as well.
That's a question I had actually about how constrained, if at all, are you by the construction budget in terms of considering alternatives for design, layout, ground structure after you've done the necessary renovation work and drainage issues and everything else? I mean, is there a sufficient amount of funding available to really make some significant changes if it turns out that the community wants to see changes made?
Well, right now, $180,000 is approved, and Allison has requested another $172,000. The $180,000, things will be tight. I don't think extremely tight. I think it won't just be fix that, fix this, and we're done. But if the additional money is approved, I think we'll be able to dream a little bigger. I can't tell you right now how big we can dream. I think I'll be able to tell you at the next meeting, because we'll, with ideas, we can start to put some rough numbers to it. But I don't want us to be constrained really tonight about that. I'd rather think big and think about everything, and then we'll figure out how to make it work.
All right. This might be the last thing I say. I'm going to go on record. I'm going to answer that question. Would you like to see the park change dramatically? Yes. Lose the trellis. Lose the fixed furniture. People are just peeing all over it and trashing it. Lose the walls, except where you need to protect people from falling. Integrate it with the rest of the square. Provide perhaps some ideas about shading. North Square gets sunlight that is devastating. Mm-hmm. We have no trees except, you know, where we don't need them.
No.
Yeah, because that's great. If we're hanging out in the power tower over there, that's great. But we have no, I don't know. There, some thoughtfulness has to go into the humanity who are going to occupy this space and use it. Make it safe for the kids, and those are the things I would like to see. I live there and have an interest in it.
There's many events that happen.
Maybe in the horizontal garden that they made in the show in the expo region, like
green walls?
Green walls. What do you mean? Small greens.
More green, okay.
More greens.
You know what I mean?
Yes, on the wall itself.
Just make a beautiful garden coming. You have that big wall that holds nothing. It would be very interesting to
have. Right. The question I have for parks is, who owns the wall?
Yeah.
And what part is the building? Do we know that?
I'm pretty sure we don't own at least the upper part of the wall.
Right. That's what I would guess.
So it might be really difficult to do a green wall. As much as I would love to, it would be fantastic here. But the other issue is maintenance. And I need to say it, parks have a really hard time maintaining landscapes in particular. We do grass okay and trees okay, but other things we don't have the staff.
Maybe it's surprised that people be interested in basic things.
So additional plantings would absolutely require friends groups and volunteers to help maintain.
And we're always open to friends groups. Right, Robin?
Yep.
Other comments? Should I go back to these questions and push you a little harder? Or?
I was just going to add that the shade is very important. It is a very sunny spot on a sunny day, and those current trees are really the only source of shade in North Square for much of the day.
Right. I just wanted to ask a question of the school again. If you could speak to the recess sessions that happen out in the street when the kids put the cones out on the street. So clearly you need more space, it seems, or just more flexibility in that space. And that seems to be a way of using North Square and Regional Revere Park that brings the two together.
Absolutely. Our enrollment has grown over the past 3 years. We were at 170 students. We're at 280 students now. So the numbers have grown. We cannot fit in the park at the same time because people will be crashing into each other. So that's why we block off Moon Street and we use Suncourt Street as well. If we had access to North Square, that would be huge because the kids would have a great space to utilize and be outside. It's important that they're outside, not only in the good weather, but all year long. I mean, even if there's snow on the ground, they can snow pants in their boots and go outside. So it's important what street, the playground on North Street, has helped eliminate some of the congestion.
It's an amazing phenomenon. I live there as well. It's just really incredible.
They bring out their cones, they put them on the street, the cars don't come by, they play.
And it's such an organic process, and it just happens. And there's so many other events that happen, whether it's funerals or weddings or even just putting a few picnic tables out in North Square. We've got picnickers and people come and paint, and there's artists and people sketch and hang with their children, and it's just really lovely. So I think there's a programmatic, there are these layers of program that kind of the place just sort of inspires people wanting to be there. It has such a good energy. And my other question is, could you talk a little bit about accessibility and how maybe, again, I think this is maybe another large topic that, I don't know, begs perhaps the two entities to come together and sort of think about this in terms of a whole, or maybe there are elements or edge conditions, surfaces, other elements that either exist or could be added that could be negotiable between parks and public parks, and I don't know, you sort of trade off or something, or flip cards or something like that, and trade off. I don't know. I think accessibility is a really large issue here.
I think it is for North Square in general. I mean, I think for Rachel Revere, it's not as difficult because of some of the materials that exist or that we. I think the cobblestone certainly, is a challenge, but it's so iconic in terms of the material. But you know, thinking about some of the different possibilities we heard tonight, the one idea you had about maybe dropping this down, I mean, it would be accessible from this level or this level, so that would work okay. The things I also wonder about, kind of thinking outside of what we're doing here, is just connections across the street, with that cobblestone there. But these are things that the Public Works Project are considered, accessibility on the sidewalks, but also throughout North Square. So it's not something that's it's required for one, but two, you want to do it in a way that feels appropriate in this site.
Yes, I've got photos and documentation. It's incredible the struggle of people who utilize wheelchairs or mothers pushing baby carriages or just footwear issues in walking in this area.
I have researched for 8 years on those streets.
So I guess I'm curious what more people think about this. Do some people say, don't change a thing, just make it better? Or I don't know, we're open to changing things a little bit, or
maybe do a mural on the wall.
Mural on the wall?
Yeah.
I think you'd be hard-pressed to make it better without making some significant changes to it for a lot of the reasons that have already been stated about. It's very Spartan right now. It's not recognizable as a playground or a recreational space. So whatever, you know, creative enhancements you can come up with to sort of improve in that portion of the equation, that would certainly be welcome, I think, by most people in the community.
So the attributes that it has now, durability, flexibility, as long as we can accommodate that with some alterations, that seems okay.
Also, it'd be really nice to see maybe in the second it'd be lovely to see maybe a selection of, you know, what would trash barrels look like, and are they just sort of elements that get picked out of a catalog and plopped in like we have right now, or is it part of the design? Could it be a little more elegant and thoughtful, like we see in other parks, let's say Madison Square Park, for example, in New York City or something, right? And the same with maybe lighting fixtures, and, you know, is it about these large cobra-headed highway lamps, or could we do something a little more elegant and really create a sense of place here? I was wondering if we could see, if we could have input on some of those selections, or, and who knows, the neighborhood could get creative and help the effort.
There's definitely some elements that we look to the community for feedback on. But the trash barrels, unfortunately, we have standard now. It's not the oil barrel you often see at parks, but it's actually a new standard trash barrel that's
a little more decorative.
And so,
smaller.
There's certain things within our parks that we like to keep consistent, and the trash barrel is one of them, or we have the big bellies. And those are kind of, the conversation's probably not going to go very far. Mm-hmm. Coming up with something creative for those elements. The lighting, I'm not sure about right now. It's all street lighting, and so interior, if we did park interior lighting, we do have some flexibility, but it all needs to be approved by street lighting in the end anyway, so it's a limited amount unless it's an art piece, then that's completely different. But then that would lead us down a 7-year process potentially. So I just want to make sure we understand what we're asking for.
Could recycling be incorporated into the trash options?
We want to recycle, but we don't have a program right now to pick it up. So with all of our designs, we're looking at making sure that there is a space provided where recycling can go when we have that program rolled out, but we just don't have a program.
In terms of, question, there's big bellies on the sidewalk right now, the face of the square, so, and that one is not recycling, but I know there are some big buildings that have recycling in the city, so I wonder if that's something that could be, that would help cut down, I think, on the amount of trash in the building.
That's not a hint that we need to wrap up.
Just to follow up on the standard for trash receptacles in the parks, are the oil can barrels going away, is that what you're saying?
Well, they will probably not always appear around, but yes, we're trying to get rid of as many as we can.
As I'm sure many of your colleagues in the Parks Department and DPW know, household trash being disposed in city great waste receptacles is a big problem in North America. And to the extent that you can put something that's a little more thoughtfully designed and also at the same time precludes people from dumping household trash would be an important thing.
So the new standard, you can go.
So the opening is much smaller, so you can't just throw a kitchen garbage bag into that.
But that's a problem.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I promised that was the last thing I was going to say. Somebody brought up New York, and I lived there when Bryant Park was transformed, mm-hmm. and I'm going to make one observation / indictment of Shercliffe again. The park itself is very, it's introverted. It is, the benches, everything points to the middle, as if there, I think you brought up, there was a flagpole in there. I know, as a kid, I ran into it 100 times, playing wiffle ball and whatever else we did in that park. I nearly put a hockey puck through the Paul Revere House window, but I will never admit it. But But the irony of it is that everything of interest is outside the park. There, the Paul Revere House, the square itself. So the it's almost as if you could take those benches, lose the walls, put them on the other side. You know, have the people sit at the perimeter, and suddenly there would be a different enjoyment.
Instead of focusing in, focus
out. Yeah, there would be a different enjoyment, appreciation of the square. There would be a way to observe and gaze at the Paul Revere House instead of precariously, you know, perched along the stanchions. We've got to lose the trains, but that, no, that's beyond the scope of this. But anyway, that somebody brought up New York, Bryant Park, introverted versus extroverted, except along, you know, the edge that you need to protect it from the most.
The Bryant Park edge conditions are just lovely, which I'm sure you are very familiar with what Olin did, and just sort of stepping up very gradually, right, to this one of the condition, right?
Which was we had that much space.
Yeah, I really did, yeah.
I have a question. Well, actually, it's a suggestion in the form of a question. Would it be possible at an appropriate time in design development of the Public Works Department and North Square and the Parks Department and Rachel Rubio Park to have a joint meeting so that we can see how the two concepts relate to each other?
Yeah, I mean, I think that we'll discuss that. Absolutely. Like, I understand that you guys want to see the two together.
Yes.
And I think that, you know, absolutely, we'll be open to a discussion about that.
I mean, at a minimum, I'll get all of these and Nelson.
Right.
And get ours. The designers here. So we are getting all the information together, but
other comments? This is your chance, because it's inspiration for us as we start to do the design.
I have a question. Is there anything else that you would like to hear from us? Do you have questions for us? Anything a little more specific that we haven't addressed for you?
Well, you've given us a lot of carte blanche, actually. You know, to really consider a little bit of everything. I mean, I understand all the different parameters in terms of the uses.
I think one thing that comes to mind, actually, with this really snow-intensive winter that we've had. So the big question is, where does the snow go? And certainly a lot of snow is dumped into the center of North Square itself, right within the chains. But there's also a lot of dumping of the snow that gets piled into Rainbow Revere Park as well. Could you speak to that? And how would this design, I mean, it would have to perhaps accommodate that, or the snow removal, the piles get moved somewhere else or something. And I'm not sure if that maybe is a negotiation, one of these things.
Hopefully we don't have another winter.
I mean, I think
something like that and plan for it.
Yeah, we're always thinking about snow plowing and how the spaces are plowed and how that potentially damages things. And so looking at that, but I also don't want to limit the design itself based on because a bunch of snow is being dumped here. And if in the end we end up not being able to dump as much snow here because of the design, then that's probably okay. We'll figure it out.
That's great to know, because I wonder if that would affect a surface choice or something, or it would limit a palette of options.
It could if there's actually like a snow plow coming into Rachel Revere, especially that would limit
the park space. Wasn't plowed at all this winter.
Right.
Until they started dumping.
Well, they were dumping at the end of North Street in front of the park. So the point
he literally drove
the little cat over
the end. I've been at Revere House for a million years. The first time I've ever seen that.
Yeah.
And I was looking out my window and I said, oh my God, there's that much snow. He was going right in, and but there was no place.
Yeah.
There really would be yeah. It was
in the snow farm still. 30
feet high. Yeah. The square was full, the end here was full, and the default to get it off the sidewalk is just push it in.
I'm going to keep talking if nobody I'm going to add an historical detail that few people probably know about. When we were kids, I'm talking about when we landed somebody on the moon, kids, at that time. Fire department used to come in, flood the park with water so that we could have an ice surface to skate on. And I haven't seen that done in years and years. Is there anybody here my age or remember? I mean, it's true. And, you know, these days we think about repurposing or multi-purposing spaces. It's just, it's something that was very exciting. We learned to skate, I did, you know, as a 7-8-year-old from until about 12 in that park, and that was something that used to happen. So there's a reason to keep the walls. So
myself in the foot. And to keep the drain not closed.
Yeah,
right,
yeah.
Then you want to block the drain more. Yeah.
Shot myself in the foot here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Never mind.
With a hockey puck in the window.
Yeah, yeah. That's where it started.
Did they make whistle hockey pucks?
Great. Well, I think that that's everybody's comment. So thank you so much for coming tonight. Like I said, our next meeting will be most likely in June, although June is just right. What next week?
Next
week. So we'll have to take a close look at that, but we'll let you know as soon as we know when the meeting is. We'll give you plenty of notice. And please spread the word that these meetings are happening to your neighbors and whoever else. Thank you.